Vedanta. Een woord wat u misschien niet zegt. Maar Vedanta heeft iets te maken met de Veda's. En dat zijn boeken die nog veel ouder zijn dan de Bijbel. Dat zijn boeken uit het oude India, waarin een paar duizend jaar geleden al hele diepe wijsheden stonden. De Veda's heet ze. En de Veda's zijn de basis van het Hindoeïsme. En dat is niet iets wat u iedere dag tegenkomt, behalve af en toe op straat, want dan komt u zo'n Krishna-figuur tegen. Zo'n man met een wat kaal hoofd en een gele jurk aan, die u een boek probeert te slijten. Nou, zo kennen we de Krishna-beweging in Nederland. En dat is een deel van het Hindoeïsme. We hebben hier vandaag bij ons Swami Suhotra, of zoals het in zijn traditie heet, Suhotri Swami. Dus een priester, een monnik in de traditie van de Krishna. En iemand die een aantal boeken geschreven heeft. Suhotra is Amerikaan. En sinds 1971 is hij dus bij deze beweging. En hij heeft twee boeken geschreven. Substance and Shadow en Transcendental Personalism. We gaan een gesprek met hem hebben en dat gaat over de realiteit. Over hoe we ervaren wat om ons heen gebeurt. De basis daarvan en de illusie. Het gesprek is in het Engels, want hij is Amerikaan. En dat is net zo makkelijk. En we hopen dat u het kunt volgen. Welkom. Swami.
Thank you.
You're American and not Indian. Do you think that makes a difference in your practice of Hinduism?
Well, I think most people who've studied Hinduism know that it's very broad-minded. So, culturally speaking, coming from American background, I did find it difficult to adapt to this very different culture of Indian religionism, but I started in 1971, so by now I've gotten quite used to it. I've been to India many times, so I think I'm part of the game.
Now, for most Westerners, Hinduism and Buddhism, that's all about the same, you know, it's some kind of strange stuff coming from the East. Mm. What is the main difference between Buddhism and Hinduism?
Well, first of all, I'd like to say Hinduism, that term is a little misleading because it would be sort of like referring to Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, lumping them all together and calling that Jordanism. Because actually Hindu, the word, comes from the name of a river, Sindhu, which people from the Middle East pronounced as Hindu because they changed the S to an H. So they just said the people who live around this river, we call them Hindus. And in India, of course, there are different religions. Even within the realm of what is called Hinduism, there are quite different religious traditions that have just been lumped together and given the name of a river. So, you know, the Jordan, River Jordan, is also holy to the Jews, the Christians, and the Muslims. So you could do the same. But I don't think it would be accepted as, you know, very scholarly or very...
Well, it's the word we use, but yes. Compare it to Buddhism, that
okay. Okay. Yes, so basically, but there is, you know, there is some basic things we could say. Hinduism is a tradition, although, again, there's different branches, but its root is the Vedas, so the Vedic scriptures. Whereas Buddhism was a kind of Protestant movement. It was actually a movement against some of the conclusions of the Vedic scriptures. It's not probably correct to say it was anti-Vedic, because there are many things that are still there in Buddhism that are also there in the Vedas, but on some fundamental points it was a Protestant movement against the Vedas. So,
but that was based, Buddhism was based in a figure, Gautama, who was a prince who turned
yes.
religious. And so is Hinduism based on a specific historic figure?
Well, ultimately, because Bhagavad Gita, which is considered to be the Bible of Hinduism, the most important single book of Hinduism, that was spoken by Krishna. So Krishna is the ultimate figure. He's the original personality. That's the idea of this book here, transcendental personalism. That there are dimensions to personality. Mostly when we think of dimensions, we think in terms of cosmos, in terms of matter or mind. Actually, the philosophy is that ultimately there are dimensions to personality. We're persons, and there is a supreme person.
Who transcends all personality.
Yes.
Yeah. Isn't that the same as they say about Jesus Christ, that he was a non-personal person, that he transcended all egotism, all like traits and personality, character traits?
Yes, yes. I think that you have a similar idea there in Christianity too. Most Christians, I think, they take personality to be a kind of ultimate fact, whereas science or even some philosophies, they tend to break personality or personalism down into something impersonal. They say that's not the final truth.
Okay, because then we're talking about truth, and that's one of the subjects of your book, because what is truth, what is reality, what do we see? These are questions that I remember that the Greeks did in about the same time as Buddha did, but in the Vedas, that's much older, they're addressed. Who are we, where are we coming from? What's reality? Let's take that last question. What is reality?
Yes. Well, this book, Substance and Shadow, largely is taking up that question. And we're dealing with the problems of perception, what we see through our senses, and then what we think about what we see in our mind. These are, I would say in the Western world, these are the two primary sources of what we take to be knowledge. Our senses, and then our mind. Well, what this book does is it goes into the realm of the senses and mind and shows that it's kind of all illusory. It's all...
The word that it used for that is maya. It's all an illusion.
Yes.
It's not real.
Yes, it's not real.
You can't... Wait a minute, but this statement is real or not?
Well, you take your Western science, because here we are, we're sitting in this studio, you've got this power stick here, the microphone, we've got the camera there. This is all products of modern Western science. And actually this electronics, it comes out of quantum physics. I mean, all these new electronical devices, they're all made possible by quantum physics. Now, quantum physics says this table is not real. That's what quantum physics says on the level of quantum reality. Of course, you can say this is...
Well, what quantum reality physics say, that at the moment that I look at it, I observe it, the equation collapses and I can see what it is. And at that moment it is there, but I can say nothing about it a moment later because it might not be there again.
Yes.
So in that sense, the it is an illusion, and so the Vedas have said that for a long time.
Yes.
The mystics have said that. But still we have a feeling that there is a reality and that
yes.
There is dream time, and if we take drugs we might even enter another space if we meditate long enough, if we pray, if we are in the presence of certain people, we have experiences that are not like the stable reality.
Yes. Well, that's a very good point that you've made. That actually, that this, what we call reality, which can be called illusion, whatever it is, this maya, it has its root or it has its origin in an ultimate reality. So therefore, this is a shadow. So a shadow is not exactly unreal. I mean, I put my hand in front of the light, there's a shadow. I can't say that it's not real. But the thing is, it doesn't really have substance. I can't do much. You know, I can't pick up a cup of water and drink with the shadow of my hand. That's the point. So I think the real point here is that we expect too much of this material reality. We expect to find ultimate fulfillment here, just on the level of senses and mind.
You mean money and material things?
Yes, material things. This is our problem in life. That we expect to become completely happy, completely satisfied. The whole of Western civilization is geared to that goal. And it's an impossible goal. And that's why nowadays, you see, because you're dealing with that in this program, you see much, much more alternative reality. People who are looking beyond the mind and the senses into the realm of mysticism, or spirit, or higher consciousness. And so the Vedas have dealt with that since thousands and thousands of years. And that's what I try to present in these books.
Now, when you were, in the 60s, in the late 60s, when you met the Krishna movement, in those days there were good philosophers, there was Popper, there were all kinds of people that were also dealing with reality. Why didn't you go to a decent university like Berkeley or whatever, Chicago, and study philosophy?
Well, I started that. I mean, at that time in the 60s, I was living in the Detroit area, and I was a student, and I had a scholarship, and I could have gone on to a big university. But after 2 years of higher studies, I dropped out. And the reason was, is that although I was being confronted, being fed with a lot of theory, I really wanted to experience something beyond this conventional mundane existence. I was just being told a lot of theories.
Oh, well, in those days you would drop some acid, isn't that enough?
Well, I tried that too, but then you come down. I wanted to go beyond even the level that you come down from. So that's when I got interested in yoga and in cosmic consciousness and those kind of things. And I started to investigate various groups that were operating even at that time, like for instance Scientology, which is a little controversial I guess these days, but and a few
others. They have a thing with reality, don't they?
Yes. Yes,
they have some grasp that although I'm not a Scientologist, I've learned that they have some understanding that makes sense.
Yeah, they seem to come to, they want to come to the level of what they called, I remember this term, clear, you know. Yeah. The consciousness becomes clear of its illusions from below, from the realm of matter. So, and I also got into Zen Buddhism. I accepted a teacher for a while who had been to Japan. But it wasn't until I met the Hare Krishna devotees that I really met people who I thought were totally committed. You know, it was like the other groups, it was, you know, come on the weekend or come, you know, for an hour a day for lessons and then go do whatever. But the Krishna movement was a total commitment. And I found that reflected in the members that I met and was speaking with, interacting with. It seemed like they had reached that level that I wanted to reach, the level from which you don't come down. So that's why I pursued this path. Mm-hmm. And I haven't been disappointed.
No, but there are also traditions in the West, like you could have gone to a monastery. There is some revival of the American monastic life. People like Brother David Steiner-Rustel and, you know, near the Esalen place, where there is new monastic tradition, which has the same level of commitment.
Yes. Well, all right. Good. So there are obviously various paths that are available, but...
What I'm trying to get at is, what's the fascination with Hinduism? I mean, it's an old religion that the Vedas are much older than other books, but what is its fascination?
Well, since you're asking me, I have to answer in a personal way. So, my fascination ultimately was this Supreme Personality, Krishna, who the name Krishna means all attractive. So, it seemed to me very logical that all of the varieties and details of this world, we take this world to be personal too. Everything is centered around persons. So, if you think of this absolute God as being some kind of abstract, impersonal, you know, light or something like that, disembodied mind, like the Greeks, that Greek idea, then that doesn't really account for all the specific varieties you see here in this world. If God is the source, you know, varieties, relationships, emotions, desires, so. It seemed logical to me that the source of everything had to be personal. When I looked at the religions that had that idea, they too were quite vague, you know. I mean, they would say God is a person, but who is that person? Well, maybe an old man.
Well, in old Judaism ideas, I mean, we had a personal God, you know, Father in Heaven, that kind of idea.
Yeah, understood.
Christianity has that too, but that's something in Hinduism where I see a multitude of personal gods, but... For you, it was Krishna, the master who, in the Bhagavad Gita, advises actually people that go into war.
Yes, well, Krishna in that Bhagavad Gita, in the 11th chapter, he reveals what is called his Vishwarup, or universal form. And within that form, you see the whole divine display of the universe and all those gods you mentioned, the various gods of Hinduism. They're all aspects of him. So, he's the supreme person. Why? Because he's all attractive. He's the source of beauty, unlimited knowledge, unlimited strength, unlimited fame and renunciation. These are called...
But is he also ultimate reality?
Yes, yes, he's the ultimate reality. That which we're looking for in our heart, when we're looking for love, when we're looking for truth, when we're looking for beauty in this world. We are actually looking for the source of those things, Krishna.
Well, why do you need it to be personal? I mean, I happen to believe in an ultimate reality, which I call God, but it has no form, it has no personality, it is, it's all.
Yeah, I think the answer, before this program started, you and I were talking, and you said you live in the shadow of love of God. And that's pretty good. That's a pretty good summation of what you're talking about. Because this world is the shadow. So in this world, as I was saying, you see all this specific variety and we're attracted to it. But the point is in the Bhagavad Gita and other Vedic scriptures, they tell us that this attraction to this phenomenal world, this is Maya, this is illusion, and this keeps us in the cycle of birth and death. So the thing to do, Krishna says, is the problem is our lack of attraction to that supreme reality. And as long as we take the supreme reality to be something impersonal, you know, something vague, not really defined, indefinite, then there's not really a basis of attraction there. We can just accept that there's something higher than this, but we don't really get involved in it, you see.
We differ here, because I truly believe it's impersonal, but it's everywhere, so I have to see it in the personal things that I see, the trees, the live people. Represent part of that ultimate reality.
Yes, but my question is, what then are you really attracted to? You see, what are you relating with in a practical way? You're relating with people, you're relating with activities here, everything is here. And of course, so you're seeing beyond it that there's an ultimate truth, but the level of your activities and your relationship and your desires is here. Whereas Bhagavad Gita is revealing a way that through this, it's not negating this. It's not that we're saying this is all sin and this is all to be rejected, flushed down the toilet. It's useless. We don't say that. We just say it's a shadow. And beyond the shadow, there is a real personality from whom this shadow and all of the varieties in this shadow is emanating. So relate to that supreme personality. And this is the process known as bhakti yoga, the yoga of devotion, of using this energy here in devotion to that person who is the source of this energy.
It feels like you're saying you're looking to the veil, to the Maya, into the personality of that Krishna.
Yes. Okay.
How does that look? I mean, is that different? Some people have experience with smoking some hajj or LSD or whatever, and you kind of come into different realities. Some of them are very colorful, and they resemble the picture that I sometimes see from, you know, Hindu art,
yes.
Where you see the goddesses with all these radiations and the colors. And say, hey, reminds me, those guys must have been on acid too. But they're not, probably, or maybe they are. Is this ultimate reality that, or is this just an intermediate step?
Well, there are many, many, many dimensions or levels of higher and lower experience. And so when you, as you've said, take psychedelics, you do enter a different dimension. But it's not the highest dimension. The highest dimension is summarized with three words, sat, chit, ananda. So sat means eternality. It means you don't come down from it. Chit means full knowledge. Full knowledge means knowing yourself to be an eternal being without a doubt, beyond the body, beyond the mind. And ananda means full of bliss. That there is a happiness which is unlimited and yet ever increasing. And all of this sat chit ananda, it comes together in a fourth word, vigraha, means form, the form of God, the form of Krishna, with whom we have a relationship in an intimately personal way. You mentioned the Indian art. So many times you'll see the beautiful paintings of Krishna playing a flute, and around him there are the gopis. They're known as the gopis. They're cowherd girls. They're young, beautiful maidens. These are his spiritual energies. They're female forms, but they're forms of pure spiritual energy. And there's a world there of trees and flowers and peacocks, a very beautiful world, but it's a world of this sat-chit-ananda, eternity, knowledge, and bliss. So it's kind of like in Platonic philosophy, they have the idea of the world of ideal forms, and this is a reflection of that. Something like that. But you can actually, Plato said, you can't see that world, you can only think of it. But this is a process of actually entering into that world and experiencing it fully with spiritual senses, with spiritual eyes, spiritual ears, spiritual sense of touch. Actually entering into the world, being
How do you get there?
Well, the Vedic process is based on sound, shabda. And that's a very important thing I present here in this book. I speak of the level of senses and the level of mind, which is our what we deal with in the West as knowledge. But beyond that, in the Vedic culture, there's the realm of shabda, or pure sound, spiritual sound, which is conveyed in mantras. So a mantra is, well, I'll just analyze the word. Man means mind or consciousness, tra means to free. So it's a special sound that frees the consciousness from illusion, that takes you beyond this conventional material reality. The example that's given is a very simple example, just like you got to get up early in the morning, so you set your alarm clock. Now, once a few seconds before that alarm clock rings, you're in a dream. You're sleeping, you're in a dream. Maybe you're dreaming you're in a jungle and there's a tiger jumping out just about ready to bite your head off. But then the alarm clock rings. And what happens when you hear that sound? You're brought out of that dream into another level of experience. You haven't changed where you are. You're in the same bed, you know. You didn't go from here to there. Your consciousness has moved up to a whole other level by that sound. And then you wake up and you look around. There's no tiger, there's no jungle. You're in your bed and you got to do something completely different that has nothing to do with that dream you were just having.
So you say mantra is a wake-up call?
Yeah, exactly. That's a good.
But you do it yourself.
Yes, you do it yourself. So for us, the Maha Mantra, the great, there are many, many mantras, but the most important.
Give a few examples.
Yes, well, there's the mantra Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. There's the Buddhist chant Om Mani Padme Hum, Tibetan Buddhist. And our mantra, Maha Mantra, the greatest mantra is Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So this is a mantra that we practice daily. We get up early in the morning.
You do it saying it loud, or you also internalize it?
Well, saying it loud does internalize it. You see, this is what is called the sadhana, the practice. You say it loud to set up a permanent vibration. So we chant, like I have my beads here, everyone can see. We chant on these beads, Hare Krishna, mantra on each bead. We go around the bead, there's 108 beads, we go around 16 times. That's 1,728 mantras every morning. And then we also have ceremonies where we sing the mantra together. And in this way you set up a vibration daily, and the vibration starts to permeate the mind and the consciousness.
Oh, I would say brainwashing yourself.
Well, brainwashing is self-hypnosis. And
what's the difference between self-hypnosis and this?
No, because hypnotism is understood to take away the will. But this process actually reinforces the will. How can I say that? Because there are many things in this world that are attracting, as I said before, in this material world, that attract our mind and senses. And they attract us into the realm of duality, sukha dukkha, it's called happiness and distress. You see, just like, I don't know, smoking a cigarette. You smoke a cigarette and you feel some happiness, but if you keep smoking, you get some disease of the lungs, and so distress follows. Mm-hmm. So our material life is composed of these two opposites, happiness and distress. Many are heat, cold, duality. And we're in the midst of that, and we get attracted. And this is a message given in the Bhagavad Gita, that even though we know better, even though we know we shouldn't do this, still the attraction is so powerful. And we get involved in something and later we regret it, but we're out of control. So
But it feels like a mantra that relinquishes control to some other entity. You give up to this rhythm, to this sound.
Yeah, but that other entity is the Supreme Self. So will...
What did you tell me? Maybe it's... I mean, it sounds a little bit like magic, you know? Mm-hmm. Like using... When we were young, we read books, how people had secret books with secret magical formulas, and if you repeat them enough, something would happen. What you're saying is the same.
No,
if you repeat this specific mantra...
Yes,
or any mantra,
something happens within yourself. That's the point. You don't turn an orange into a beautiful girl, but...
Westerner into an orange-dressed
Hare Krishna. Okay, I can see
that. There is magic there.
Yes, there is that kind of transformation. But basically, it is happening within yourself. And as I'm saying, it's actually a fulfillment or a strengthening of the will. Because it is only by spiritual will that we can get out of this duality of illusion. So Yeah, or you said surrendering to a higher entity, but I was going to explain that that higher entity is Krishna, the Supreme Self. We are part of that Supreme Self. This is also a teaching in the Vedic scriptures, that we are simultaneously one and different from God. So we're one with Him in the sense that He is spiritual, He is transcendent, and so are we. We're different in terms of the loving relationship. You know, like the French say, vive la difference, you know, that between the beauty of sexual relationships between man and woman is the difference between the two. And because of this difference, they can enjoy. So the same is there between the soul and God. There is a difference, but that difference is for enjoyment. Otherwise, there's a oneness at the same time. So when you speak of surrendering to a higher entity, it's a surrender to the higher self. Mm-hmm. So it's not a surrender to something that is radically different or other than me, you know, that's going to control me. But it's just coming to the higher, the platform of the higher self.
Suhotra, yes, that's true. But there's another way. I mean, the Sufis, they say, if you want to be...
not really
do your work as a humble, mender of something, or like a craftsman, or even television maker, whatever. And you do your work in the reality, you don't dress up different, you don't act different, but you do act from this God awareness, of this total awareness that whatever you do is part of bliss, and you know, you have to radiate good energy. You dress up, you have a practice, takes you a lot of time. Have you been to the movies lately?
No, but I am on a television show right now. And that's the point. We do interact with the world, but we do it in terms of Krishna consciousness. This is the lesson of the Bhagavad Gita. The whole Bhagavad Gita starts with Arjuna, who's a warrior. You were mentioning that. So Arjuna was a warrior in the ancient Vedic culture. So war at that time was also a kind of sacrifice. It wasn't just something you did because you got angry with the guy next door. But it was all very controlled and guided by scriptural injunction. There had to be real reasons why there would be a war, and it had to happen in a certain place. It couldn't just happen in the middle of the city and kill lots of innocent people. So it was very, very guided.
Ritualized.
Ritualized. And that actually reduced the occasions for war in society, because it was done that way.
Yet, since the last World Wars, there is a tendency to say, never war again. And then I read the Bhagavad Gita about the brothers, the Pandavi brothers, and you know, the whole story is, hey, here is a very old tradition that says war at some times is justified and necessary.
Yes. Yes, in the realm of that level of dharma, Arjuna represents a level of dharma, dharma means religion, called Kshatriya dharma. He was a member of the warrior caste. So that is, their duty in life is to protect the citizens, to make sure that there is no exploitation, and so on and so forth. So when necessary, they use arms to protect the principles of religion. Yeah, so sometimes it is necessary, but rarely so. Anyway, he was a warrior, and things had developed, the political situation had developed as such that his own family, his own dynasty, had become divided. And so the armies that were facing one another on the field of Kurukshetra were from the same family. And so he's there, the war is just about ready to start, and he has a breakdown. He's looking at his former teacher, Drona, he's looking at his grandfather, Bhishma Dev, he's looking at his cousin brothers over there, and he's thinking, wait a minute, I grew up with them, you know, I know them, what's happening here? I'm going to fight with them, I'm going to kill them, or they're going to kill me. And so he loses heart. And he begins to cry, and he tells Krishna, I can't do this. And so he gives all kinds of reasons why this is not a good thing to do. And the whole Bhagavad Gita after, that's the first chapter, and the whole Bhagavad Gita after that, 17 more chapters, Krishna is explaining that you have to act. This is unavoidable. You can't avoid to do this. The situation has come to this point. There's no way out of it. But so the only way is that you have to act from the platform of the soul. You have to realize that nobody is going to die here. Some bodies may collapse, but the souls will live on. And by engaging in this war here on this holy field under these principles of religion, all these souls are going to be liberated. They're all going to be promoted to the highest spiritual dimension. So there's nothing to cry about here. So
I bring this to reality. In Iran, there is Saddam Hussein,
yes,
who is not called Krishna, but has a similar story. And he said, come on guys, go out and beat the Americans.
Yeah.
Because it's good for you and you'll live forever after. Oh, this body will collapse, but who cares?
Yeah. So you're asking me what I have to say about that?
No, to bring the story of the Bhagavad Gita into reality now, that there are wars going on, and some of those wars are in our eyes unjustified, and in their eyes very justified.
Yes. Well, the Bhagavad Gita is not—it's not a text that is specifically aimed at the case of war. How I understand this is that Arjuna's situation was the most difficult of all, because he was a soldier, and he did have that obligation to fight. So, but the message of Bhagavad Gita is actually universal. The real understanding there is that if Arjuna could do it, then you definitely can do it, because your situation, however bad it may be now, is not as bad as his, is not as extreme as his. So now, the wars that are fought today, I mean, you know, although religion is sometimes introduced into these wars as being a justifying factor, I mean, if you really look at the cause of these wars, it's politics. It's because people are trying to claim a piece of land to be their own, or something like that. And this is again illusion, because we're not going to remain in this world, so we can't lay claim to anything here. Now, the war presented in the Bhagavad Gita, the ultimate issue, there were also different political issues, but they were lesser. The ultimate issue was actually the fate of mankind, or the direction of Dharma, of religion, of the civilization at that time. And Krishna, who is the Supreme Lord, had descended. He says in the Bhagavad Gita, I have come because religious principles now are deteriorating, they're now breaking down, and I have come to revive them. And so there were persons who were resisting that. These were powerful kings.
It sounds like you feel that we're in a similar time.
Well, what I think I want to say is that in our modern world, we have completely come under the influence of materialism. In other words, if there is religion, that religion is kind of a servant of...
But isn't that your own projection? I mean, you're a child in the 60s, and blaming the material world is a story that we've heard over the past, well, not so much lately, blaming capitalism, materialism, and hiding in some kind of Buddhism, Hinduism, escaping the world. That was the 60s energy, isn't it? Is that over now?
It's a 60s thing.
What is projection and what is reality?
Yeah,
the fact that you joined this movement is also your personal need for, as you say, commitment and an environment.
Yes. But this conflict between materialism and spiritualism, it's a theme that's always been there. I mean, it's throughout history. It's not just the 60s, you know. I mean, you can go through history and you can find it's a common theme. It's there all the time.
Yeah, but some people in the 60s went and became part of the Kennedy Corps, the Peace Corps, and they went out in Africa and tried to do their best.
Yes.
We now found out it wasn't so good most of the time. But so you did. You joined an organization, a religion, and you still find happiness in it?
Yes, otherwise I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be dressed like this if I didn't.
But are you saying to present-day youngsters or people, this is a good way?
What I'm saying is that unless we come to the deepest level of the self and the deepest level of our relationship with the Supreme Self, with God, with Krishna, that we are not going to be fulfilled in what we are doing. And all of this, when I say materialism, I'm not saying that this TV studio is bad. I'm not saying that trucks and cars out on the street are bad and should be shoveled into the ocean. I'm not saying that. That's happening. That's what's happening. But materialism, it's an attitude. It's a human attitude. It's when a human being thinks that this is all there is, and happiness, I want happiness, and I've got to get happiness out of this, there's nothing else. That's what I mean by materialism. Mm-hmm. So I'm saying that if we don't come to the ultimate platform of the self and relationship with the Supreme Self, then no matter what we do with our trucks and cars and airplanes and electronics, etc., computers, etc., etc., we're actually not going to be happy. There's always going to be this existential unease. It's just like now, what do they call it? The X generation. You know, the current generation of young people. So the attitude that they project is one of disinterest, of one of, I've seen it all, been there, done that, you know. Nothing excites me, it's all pretty boring. So what does that mean? It means they're frustrated, it means they're not happy. And that's why I say that this problem, it's not a 60s thing, it's always there. And it's always been the subject matter of philosophical thought and religious endeavor and so on and so on.
Mm-hmm. Now, you not only practice Hinduism, but you actually teach in Holland at various occasions. I assume you do that all over the world.
Yes.
How does that go? Is it you responding to questions? How do I see your teaching?
Well, right now I'm in Amsterdam. We have a center in Van Hillegardstraat, and I'm giving classes there every day. They're open classes. We have our members of our society there, but also members of the public come. And I present this knowledge. And yes, people ask me questions. People come for private talks. People ask me how they can apply this knowledge in their life. Sometimes that means that they do like I did, or like he did, you know, enter the Krishna movement. But it doesn't have to mean that. That's another point I want to make clear. It's not an either-or message. Either you're in the Krishna movement or you're in Maya. But actually our Krishna movement, the way we look at it ourselves, it's a kind of educational movement. We want to distribute this spiritual knowledge through society. And however people take it, that's wonderful. It's better than not taking it. So even if they just take a book home and read it and think about it, that's a start. That's wonderful. And in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, any step you take on this path, that is an eternal step. You're never going to lose it. Never going to lose it. Even whatever happens in the future, you take birth here or there, you're never going to lose that. One step leads to the next step, leads to the next step. So this is actually what we're trying to do.
Is there an evolution in the Krishna movement in the sense that maybe 10 years, 15 years ago, I got my first Bhagavad Gita, I've actually read it, and I got the commentaries from some guy with a very long name.
You A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Yes.
That kind of guy. And I found it a bit heavy. Mm-hmm. Yeah. His native language wasn't probably English. It was translated. It was too heavy. Now, you are native English speaker and writer. Is the knowledge becoming more easily digestible?
Yes. Because Srila Prabhupada, the author of the Bhagavad Gita, did, you know, he's guru means heavy. The word guru in Sanskrit actually means heavy. So he came to the Western world at the age 70. He knew he didn't have very many years left on this level. So he gave everything. It splashed into Western consciousness like a big meteor falling from the opposite side of the universe, made a big splash, made big waves, big reverberation, and people were wondering, what is this? It's too heavy. But what it did was it opened up our receptivity to this Vedic understanding, and now things are developing. And that trail was blazed, and now the fruits and flowers are growing, and people are finding it to be more and more attractive.
Because people like you are making more bridges between Western philosophy and our culture, our tradition, and what is said in the Vedas.
Yes, yes, this is what we're trying to do. We're trying to make it more accessible to people. And people on the other side, the people are opening up. The New Age movement, this is all evidence that people's consciousness are opening up to these ideas. They're, you know, the spaces are developing that can be filled by Vedic knowledge. There's a broader vista, you know, a broader receptivity. So that's very positive.
After you've studied the Vedas for a long time, would you say that they're fundamentally different from what we know as the Gnosis, the old Bible, or the basic truths of the Islam?
No, fundamentally not. Fundamentally not at all. As a matter of fact, by my study of the Vedas, I have come to appreciate much, much more the Bible than I ever could before. One of the reasons you have been asking, why did I take to the Krishna movement? Why did I take to the Bhagavad Gita? Well, one of the reasons is that I could understand it. It meant something to me. Whereas previously when I'd read the Bible, I don't know, I just couldn't get the hang of it. It just didn't, you know, click. But after I started this practice and became more aware of Vedic knowledge, then I could see that the same truths are there in the Bible. So fundamentally there is no difference. One could say that there is a difference in quantity, because the Vedas form an entire encyclopedia. And recently I read a Western scholar, he's saying that if you take all the Vedic books and you even compare them to all the literature of ancient Greece, the Iliad, the Odyssey, there's no comparison. The Vedas are so vast, there's so many, many volumes. And, you know, it's like a little dictionary.
Maybe it had a better preservation process.
Yes, no doubt.
Because now we're finding parts of the Bible and scriptures from those early Christianity that were hidden before.
Yes.
They still find them.
That's true. But, ultimately, when I say Vedas, the word Veda just means knowledge. It's not a sectarian canon, you know. It's not like some canonical... That's the right word, canonical compilation, you know, approved by some pope or something like that. The word Veda literally means knowledge, that's all it means. So it's spiritual knowledge, transcendental knowledge. And that's why I'll include the Bible, the Torah, the Quran, also as Veda, because it's giving knowledge.
And how about relativity theory by Einstein or quantum physics? Does it come close?
It's on the, of course, that's dealing with the material world. Scientists don't pretend, the scientists admit. Some scientists are atheists, some aren't, but all of them say, we don't deal with anything beyond matter. That's not science, and that's their bottom line. So, but relativity, if you take it, meaning that time in different regions of the universe is perceived differently. I think that's a principle. That's a very basic part of Vedic knowledge. That there are dimensions in this universe. There's a level, the topmost level in this universe, called Brahma Loka. And there, the leading personality, whose name is Brahma, he's got four heads, he's the creator of this universe. He lives a lifetime, which in his perception is 100 years, just like a man on this plane might live for 100 years too. For him, time goes by the same rate it goes by for us. But yet from our point of view, he's living for 311 trillion solar years. You see? And from his point of view, we're living, you know, like a microbe or something, you know, just like that, or come into being and...
One breath of his is a universe for us.
Right, something like that. So, so this relativity, this understanding of the relativity of time, That's a very intrinsic part of Vedic knowledge. And quantum physics, yes, the same thing. That matter comes out of a wave function. this is, you know, these particles, this is what the quantum physics, they come out of a probability wave. So that's, in the Vedas, there's this fundamental wave called prana. It's the life energy or life vibration. And the perception of matter arises out of that. So there's fundamentally everything in the universe is prana or sound.
So there is, so between what we now know as science and the old Vedas, there is
there's considerable correlation.
Well, correlation with time is that we're out of time. Suhotra Swami, thank you for explaining a little bit about Hinduism and the Krishna movement.
Thank you very much for having me here, and I hope to see you all again. Hare Krishna.